Y'all hear me up there? That is great. Now, I like to walk around stages, but I'm going to apparently have to stick around here so you guys can hear me a little bit. All right. Hello, developer track folks. I am David Jones-Gilardi, as Kurt just said. I'm a GenAI nerd, focused on Python these days. I've been coding for almost 30 years now in a bunch of different languages and everything. I found that, you know, over that time, for especially a job that keeps us a lot at our seats and in our desks, it's good. I like to do things like American Ninja Warrior and that kind of deal, just to kind of keep some physicality. It keeps my energy and coding energy up. Oh, you've got a...
Why not? I do walk around. Already on? Oh, listen to that. I like that better. All right. All right, here we go. All right. So our quick agenda for this tech talk, right, is really kind of a three-part story here. We're gonna hit a little bit on some of the stuff that Carter was showing about RAG pipelines. We want to learn more about RAG, but we're going to go a little deeper, right? So the first thing we want to do is kind of, you know, talk about the problem space. What is it that we are actually trying to solve with RAG, right? Even on the panel earlier, RAG, that acronym keeps coming up. We really haven't talked about what it is and what it means. So we're gonna deal with that. Then, in order to really understand RAG and what you can do with RAG, you need to know something about vector embeddings, right? So we're gonna do a little bit of a primer on vector embeddings. We're gonna experiment with some a little bit. And then we're gonna dig more into actually what RAG really is. And then we are going to finish up by building a RAG pipeline. Okay, so the problem space. I think I know how many hands I'm going to see from the question that Chet asked earlier. But how many folks here have used ChatGPT or Anthropic or pretty much any of the LLM chatbots? Let's see. Okay, awesome. Now, just think to yourself, what would happen if you just asked an open-ended question? You went to ChatGPT and said, when did I start coding? What's it going to do? Right? It's probably going to give you an answer kind of like this, right? Let's go ahead and do this for real. Move down this mic.
Hopefully that's not a bad idea. All right, so if I come in here into ChatGPT, can we all see that, by the way? Should I blow it up a little bit more? A little hop up there. If I come in here and I say, when did I start coding, right? It's probably not going to know.
It's not going to have a real good idea. It doesn't have the context. It doesn't know anything about my domain, right? It doesn't know anything about my personal domain unless you happen to be a celebrity or something like that. It's the same thing for your domain, your business domain, your personal domain, or something like that. Maybe there's a good chance, because the LLMs are trained on this huge corpus of knowledge from the internet and such like that and other various sources, that if you kind of maybe asked a question about your company, it might know some general knowledge, but it's not going to know detailed knowledge, right? So the problem that we're trying to solve is, how do we augment the LLMs in such a way where we can add context so they know something about us, something about our domain? All right, so let's get into it. Now, I mentioned that we are going to get into vector embeddings. We're going to do a little primer on vector embeddings so we can understand RAG better. So what are vector embeddings, right? They are a representation of data that computers can easily understand. This is about as succinct as I could figure this out, right? So here's what I'd like you to do. I want everybody to take these images, put them in your mind, and mentally group them however you want. I give everyone a moment to do that. And then I have a suspicion that even though every one of us probably used different properties to group these items, that generally speaking, you probably had kind of similar groupings, right? Coffee and tea, they're both drinks. Maybe they're served out of mugs, you know, things like that. They're kind of similar. You know, a pig and a cow, they're animals just like a tiger. Those are similar, but pigs and cows are usually, say, domesticated or on a farm. Tigers, not so much. Tigers are a predator, things like that. The computer monitor, which is, by the way, my GenAI version of Zork. But here, anyone here played the original Zork? There were no pictures in Zork. But that's actually a pretty cool picture, honestly. but, you know, that one's even further removed. Now, even though I may not know exactly what every one of you thought, there's a really good chance that intuitively, we were all able to just start grouping these things, right, in a similar fashion. So the challenge, though, is how do we take that kind of intuitive grasp of what we're seeing, the properties that are in these objects, and how do we map them in a way that a computer can understand? So now what I want to do is let's take those same images, those same items that we had. But this time, what we're going to do is we're going to map them out on this 2D space here, right? And then we're going to apply some properties to them. Now, this is like super contrived, right, for this example. But you'll see on the vertical, the y-axis there, I have wild versus domestic. And on the bottom x-axis there, I have non-living versus living. So now what's super cool about this is that you can start to map values, actual values that encode information about these properties. Right, so take the computer, way off in the, you know, it's not living, it's not really wild or domestic, obviously. These properties, like I said, is very contrived, but it's like way off in the corner, it's not related to anything else. But you might look at the coffee and the tea, and you're like, well, wait a minute. Why isn't that all the way over along with computer as far as like the non-living property? Well, think about it. It depends on how you encode it. Both tea and coffee come from living things. They might not be living now, but you can start to encode that kind of information in the representations of the properties that you have. And again, like for the, you know, the tiger, wild versus domestic, you know, the big and the cow up there, same kind of deal. So you can start to just take and, again, start mapping numerical representations to various properties. So let's take an actual example. All right, I'm going to put this mic down again.
So Carter was just showing you a minute ago AstroDB, right? And, you know, just to kind of step into that a little bit, you know, AstroDB is a fully-fledged database, but it is also optimized for vector storage and retrieval. So someone might just look at this and be like, dude, wow, you're showing a bunch of arrays. That's great. Like, we've been storing arrays in databases for decades. What's the big deal? Right? This isn't special. But what's actually happening here is a little bit different. So what I've done is I've taken the same exact that we just had a moment ago. Ooh, you can't see that yet. You're not supposed to see that yet. I'm taking the same example that we had here. So take a look at these little two-dimensional arrays I have. And then I've just stored them as two-dimensional vectors in our vector store. So what it allows you to do, I'm going to pull that out just a little bit so we can, there we go. What it allows you to do is now I can perform what's called a vector similarity search, right? And so what's really cool about what's happening about this, why this is different, why this isn't just I'm just storing arrays and, you know, matching them or something is like that, because the vector similarity search is actually a distance calculations. It's actually taking these arrays in vector space and calculating the distance based off of those. That's what that similarity score is. So when I click on, say, computer terminal, which is not really similar to much anything, you can see it has a similarity of 1, which means it is a perfect match, right? 0 would mean not so much. But then you can see, now notice that the same representation that we saw in our 2D graph a moment ago, right, is what we're actually seeing teased out in our data. This isn't because I've like massaged the data set to work like this. This is actually the vector similarity search looking in this two-dimensional space, right? We'll do it with coffee here. You should probably see coffee and tea, those groupings, the same kind of things, and coming out with these results. Now,
that two-dimensional example is just like a super simple example. Real vector embeddings look like this, right? And partially the reason I do it that way is because we can't visualize 1,536 dimensions, but we can visualize 2 pretty easily, right? So this one here, this is the text embedding model. This is OpenAI's ADA02. This is the embedding for the phrase computer terminal. Now, if you remember, I was talking about the information that we can then encode in the vector embeddings, right? So what it's doing, if you take a look at that example down at the bottom, a little asterisk says encodes properties such as associated actions, typing commands, displaying information, you know, computing, networking, things like this. So it is pulling both semantic and contextual knowledge, assigning them those various properties, right, and then storing that in these numbers in the array that you see that is encoding the information that is essentially knowledge about what this is, right? So let's take a look at some more examples. So I'm going to pop over here. Where'd my stuff go? There we go.
All right. So this time, I'm going to come over, and we're going to take a look at a full example. I don't know about you, but I've been noticing some network fun today. It's always like that every time at events like this, right? There we go. OK. So now what we have is similar to what I was showing a moment ago, where we had that full, that big vector example, right, with the text embedding model. You saw Carter talk about it earlier, right, with Vectorize. So I actually use Vectorize. I'm also using NVIDIA in this case with the MV embed QA model. And what I've done is I've fed it a data set that is essentially just a bunch of things. So we took the same, you know, the tiger, the pig, everything we had before. I just added more stuff in there. I added more things that were alive, things not alive, things like that, and gave them descriptions. And what I'm doing is I'm taking the description and I am vectorizing that into these vector embeddings. So what that allows us to do is some cool stuff. So let's go ahead and grab a text, pop it over, and do this natural language search. Now, while that's happening, what's happening here is it is actually going to take this text, right? This is kind of what Carver was talking about in the movies thing. It's going to vectorize using that NVIDIA's model, and then it's going to apply the embedding that's generated on the fly to the other ones that I have here. And now you can see that I just said a device used to play video games, and now I have game console, right? And you can see a pretty high similarity. But where this gets really interesting, and I think we're seeing a lot of this growth in AI and like some of the capabilities, is look what else it did. By just using this phrase, just a device used to play video games, yes, I get game console, but then I also get a high similarity to speaker, VR headset, monitor, mouse, things that are clearly related to that. But this isn't a wildcard search. This isn't, or anything like that. I can't, if I tried that, it would never work, right? It allows me to use these more natural language kind of searches. Let's do another one. Okay, so domesticated farm animal, known for producing milk. What do you think is probably going to show up on that one, right? Given my list here. And some of these are kind of funny. And some are kind of, you don't expect them really until they show up. I always love when you get the spinner. All right, that's taking longer than I want it to take. That's taking longer than it normally takes, that's for sure. Oh, let me see. All right, I'm going to blame it on the Wi-Fi, and I'm going to move on from that. But I think you get the idea, right? So you can do these kind of natural language searches. And again, some of these phrases, like when you start to look at the related items that come back, that one in particular, it'll show things like goat and pig and other things that, you know, are domesticated farm animals that we know for producing milk, right? So again, it's encoding information from not only the semantic information, but contextual information as well. And that's what gets encoded in those vector embeddings. Now, you know, that's just a small primer. That is a super small primer on vector embeddings. If you want to know more, if you want to go deeper, right, scan that QR code, that'll bring you to a blog post. That goes into a lot more detail and has a lot of really great examples on how vector embeddings work and everything. And so this kind of sets your knowledge a little bit for how RAG works. Okay, so now let's dig into RAG. So we have a little bit of a primer on vector embeddings. We understand a little bit more what those mean, how they work. So let's break down this acronym, Retrieval-Augmented Generation. So with RAG, what we're doing is we are retrieving data that we can then use to augment the LLM and change its generation, right? So if you remember the question that I asked earlier, when did I start coding, right? Well, again, the LLMs had no context. It didn't know what I was talking about. And I haven't retrieved anything. I haven't augmented the LLM, right? And I haven't changed its generation. So let's go ahead and pop on over. Oh, there they are, finally. Yeah, that took a lot longer than it normally does. But you can see now I have these relationships between like cow, sheep, pig, things like that. All right. So what we're going to do is we're going to bring that over here and pop back over. All right. So you saw this earlier. Carter was showing you Langflow earlier, right? And so we're going to go ahead and zoom in. And this is similar kind of what he had with the RAG pipeline setup, but we're going to dig into it a little bit more. So what I've got going on here is in order for the LLM to know anything about my particular context, when did I start coding, well, I have to give it that information, right? And by the way, there was a gentleman who was sitting over here who asked that question about like, well, with the, you know, the context limit growing, can't we just shove everything into the LLM kind of thing? I might be paraphrasing that a little off. And just rely on that context. And I'll show you why that's that's not really a great approach. But let's take a look. So first thing I want to do is I have this deck that I built a while ago that just happened to be on my career. And the things in particular I want to point out are these right here. I'm around 8 years old, started learning how to code games on a Commodore 64. I just showed my age right there for anybody who's familiar with the Commodore 64. And so what I want to do here is I first need to get that data into my vector store, right? So what I can do in Langflow has all these components. You can see all these components here on the left-hand side, right? There's inputs, there's outputs, and things like that. There's data components. This is one of those. So I'm going to load this file, this everything in 20 sides PDF. That's that PDF that you just saw. Now, you have to do a little more, though. You can't just say load the file in and you're good to go, right? So there is a method called chunking. And this actually comes down, by the way, to part of the context size, part of the embedding model that you're using, things like that. But you want to optimize the text chunks that you are pulling out of a given document in the way that you store them and you vectorize them in the database. Because for one, if you just take a huge document and you vectorize that whole thing, well, now you're losing a bunch of detail, right? You've got 1,536 dimensions for this particular embedding model. It sounds like a lot, but you're going to start losing some details if you try to chunk out too much at one given time, right? So we use this methodology, this method called chunking. This is just one way to do it. And what this says here is this is going to iterate over every 1,000 characters in my document, and it's going to chunk them into separate little pieces. Matter of fact, I'll go ahead and just do this real quick. So it's going to chunk them into 1,000 character pieces, and then it's going to vectorize each one of those, right? And you see this little component here, right? In this case, I'm using OpenAI's embeddings. Langflow is totally agnostic. It just doesn't care. There we go. Yeah. So there's all sorts of different embedding models and things like that. But what this means is now for all of those characters, if we take a look, you can see here, I'm now chunking through, right? These are each set of chunks that are now going to use OpenAI's embedding model in this case, right? We're going to use that model to create vector embeddings to store in our database. And in this case, I have this collection called Langflow in the Level Up Your RAG database. So if I come back over here and I refresh this guy, right, there it is. And you can see, oh, wait, that was weird. Now that's super, this is a fun one right here. That is not, I don't know if I'm having a rendering issue. There we go, that was super weird. Okay, here we go. All right, so check it out. You see these chunks, right? The content, each one. So this is those same chunks that we just saw a second ago over in Langflow. So it's now stored that in our vector store. So great, now we have our data. So this is the first part of a RAG pipeline. Now, when you're generating, you're not limited to like a batch upload. You could totally do this real time. Matter of fact, we actually have another app that we built it's like a wiki chat. It actually took all of Wikipedia. We vectorized the whole thing, but that's only one part of it. Every time somebody makes an update, Wikipedia has an API. You can listen on that API and you can watch for changes. So every time a change comes in, it's automatically then taking that data in and then adding to our RAG store. Right, it's essentially making it smarter. So you can have a real-time conversation with Wikipedia effectively, right? So you have multiple options here. Okay, so now we have our data, and now we go to do the query, right? So I'm gonna go ahead and run that real fast. And again, it's the same kind of deal, where here I'm gonna take this when did I start coding, I want to convert that into a vector embedding. Now this is super important right here, what I'm just about to tell you for your RAG pipeline. Notice that both my generative part of my flow and the query part of my flow are using the same embedding model. That is super important. Because if you were to embed, let's say you store your data in your vector store, let's say you store it and you use text embedding 3small, but then you decide, well, I'm going to go ahead and use like one of Grok's models, or I'm going to use Anthropic to pull it back. That's not going to work, right? That's not going to work at all. So you have to make sure you're using the same embedding model for your generation and your query. Okay. Now again, we're going to perform that query against the same database, right? Same one we just did a second ago. We're going to pull some data back. Matter of fact, notice this right here. Notice that I have this one result. And what I want to point out is out of all the results it could have chosen, it in fact chose the correct one. Now this goes back to the question that the gentleman asked earlier about, you know, the context limits and they're so big and can't you just put everything in there? What happens if you had 1,000 documents or 1,000,000 documents or something like that, right? You're not gonna, not only that, relevancy matters. If you just take a bunch of data and you throw it at the LLM and then ask it a question, it may not get the right answer. You want the most relevant results that you can then apply to the context of the LLM, right? So we're gonna do that. We're gonna feed those results. That result is then gonna go into its prompt. So now if you take a look at my prompt, you can see here, using the context above, we've injected the prompt. And now when we take a look at our result, it says you started coding when you were around 8 years old learning how to code games. So we went from the LLM not knowing anything about me, right, not having context, to now in real time being able to augment the knowledge of the LLM.
And so this also gets to another question of, again, with the context, you know, the context limits and that kind of deal getting bigger. At the end of the day, another reason why, for now anyway, right, using a RAG pipeline is actually a very smart way to go, is because calling a database is a lot cheaper than an LLM. When you are sending all those tokens, you're paying for that, right? Every time you send those big chunks of tokens, you're paying for that to the LLM. But you can do that a lot more efficiently and faster and retrieve back the most relevant results and only feed it the context that is needed, right, for a particular question. And this becomes more and more of a need the bigger and bigger your data gets. All right, so in summary, we discussed the problem space, right? We looked at what it is we're trying to solve with RAG. We learned how to apply the context to an LLM. We dove a bit into vector embeddings, so hopefully you got something out of that and built a RAG pipeline. And now you all know RAG. And with that, thank you very much.